Well, good afternoon and welcome to Good Friday. Who's happy to be here?
Yeah.
Outside the house today. I was going to say in the house. We're outside.
Who's in the house? In the room.
In the room. We're outside of the room, but it is good to be in the amphitheater. Beautiful weather. Welcome to Calvary. We're so happy that you came to join us. If you're here for your first time, you're invited by a friend. We're so pumped you're here. Church, can we make some noise for all the first timers?
Yeah. So good. Hey, we also want to welcome everyone that just joined online. We are officially live online, so we have people across the globe joining us. Can we
make
put
some
our
noise.
Hands together
Come
for
on.
Them? Yeah, we want to welcome them.
They're kind of excited that
Well, if you're
watching.
Online, you don't. This next announcement isn't as much for you because we've got food here in person. If you're still hungry, CY is selling sandwiches and box lunches. They've only got lunches available up at the top of the stairs now. So thank you. You are helping them fundraise for the weekend.
And then Vitalant Blood Services is here on campus till 3 p.m. We believe the center message of Good Friday is that blood saves lives.
Yeah.
It's the blood of Jesus Christ that washes us white as snow, makes a way for us to get to the Father, and saves us spiritually, but physically, our blood can save people's lives all around the world, but especially here in New Mexico. So if you want to be a part of saving lives, you can register after the service to give blood up in the parking lot.
That's right. And they're going to be there until 3 p.m., so you don't have to, like, give blood as soon as this is over. You can sign up for something and come later. Also, just want to remind you where the restrooms are today. SoPo is open for business, but they also have restrooms available in there. And there's also restrooms over here in the hub. But service is going to be short. It's about an hour long. We're going to worship together, hear a great message.
Hey, who's looking forward to Easter sunrise service at UNM Lobo Stadium? We're so pumped. It's one of the best services every year. 7:30 a.m. At Lobo Stadium. Make plans to come and bring a friend. Get there early. Get a parking spot. Get bundled up. Get some coffee, get a donut, and enjoy a great service. We have Austin French, who's going to be with us. It's going to be a great time. And then, of course, we have our 9 and 11 o'clock services back here at the Osuna campus. We also have a 10 a.m. at our Westside campus and an 11 a.m. at our Santa Fe campus. And then at 1 p.m. here at the Osuna campus, we're going to have an Easter egg hunt. We've got over 5,000 eggs that we're going to let the kids run wild all through the park and get. So make sure to come with your family out to one of those services or events.
Hey, in just a few minutes, we are going to lift our voices and let this city know that Jesus died to save them from their sins. And we wanted to provide, a few people are like grateful for that. We wanted to provide lyrics for you so that you can sing loud and you can sing along with us. Of course, we're going to have them on the big screen over here, but you can also pull up all of the lyrics for the songs that we're singing today on your phone. Just go to easterabq.com/lyrics and you'll see our set list and the lyrics there. You can also scan the QR code on the screen and on the posters throughout campus today.
And then lastly, right over here at the corner of the glass atrium, we have these little pieces of paper. This is seed paper, and this is a special part of the service. We want you to pick a piece of this paper up, and this is paper that once you plant it in the ground, wildflowers will actually grow out of this paper. And this year, our theme is all about the ground. Good Friday is into the ground. God was laid, Jesus, into the tomb like a seed, and out of that seed came eternal life for all mankind when he rose from the dead after 3 days. So we encourage you to pick up a piece of this paper and write down something in your life that you need to let die so that new life can come from it. And then just as that seed will go into the ground and die and flowers will come from it, believe that God will turn your ashes into beauty and that he will restore the years the locusts have eaten. So make sure to pick up a piece of that, write down something, and take that home with you today.
Well, we'll see you soon as we get started in service and worship in just a few moments.
And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath till that stone was moved for good. For the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel, true the Lord, shall not kneel and shall not fade, and by his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. Thank you.
Well, good afternoon and welcome to our first Good Friday service. Can everyone get on our feet? We're going to get ready to worship the Lord in this place today. Who's ready to worship and sing praises to the King of Kings, the one who conquered death, the one who conquered the grave, the one who loosed us from our sin, our shame, and our bondage? It is a beautiful day to be in church outside. Can you join me as we open up in a word of prayer? Lord, we are so thankful to be in this place, the beauty of your creation, Lord. And God, in this place, we join all of creation. We join the flowers and the trees. We join the rocks, Lord. We join the grass. We join the sunshine and the clouds and the wind. And Lord, we sing praises to the Most High, Creator of heaven and earth. Lord, we are so thankful that 2,000 years ago, you sent your Son down to this earth to live a perfect life, to die on the cross for our sins, to make a way for us to get to you. Lord, we stand in this place in this moment, Lord, and I look at these white flowers on the trees, and I'm reminded of Isaiah, "Come now, let us reason. Though your sins are red like scarlet, I will wash them white as snow." And so, Lord, we stand here in this place 2,000 years later, redeemed, refreshed, cleansed, so thankful for what you've accomplished on the cross. It is not just a Good Friday, Lord. It is a glorious day. And so we join all of creation and declare your goodness, your glory, and your mercy. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Come on, church, let's worship.
Put your hands together like this.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my
Come on, sing it out.
you call me a citizen.
Come on, let's take it up a notch.
When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. It's when you call my name.
Come on, Trey, shout it out.
Shouts of praise in this place. All right, we're not done praising just yet. Let's go ahead and put those hands together. Every voice in this place.
There was another one. I am free. I am free. I am free. There was another one. I am free. I am free.
Come on, let's shout it out.
Another one, I am free. Yes, I am free. I am free. There was another one, I am free. I am free. It's me, yeah.
darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Yeah.
on every hand lifted in this place as we declare this together as a church.
Have a seat and turn your attention to the screens for a video we have prepared for you.
And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living being. Cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life, till you return to the ground. For dust you are, and to dust you shall return. He went a little farther and fell on the ground. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. The earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies,
welcome to our Good Friday service. You know, usually, yeah. Usually we keep this outdoor area as an overflow for our indoor meetings. So a lot of times on Sundays, there'll be a few hundred people, several hundred people out here while we're meeting inside. But when we meet outside like this, we have to have another overflow. And that's out in the parkway, out on the Greenbelt. We have it all set up, and I hear it's packed full of people out there. So let the people out in the Greenbelt know that you know they're there and that you love them. Yeah. That was awesome. Now, be very, very quiet. And we're going to hear from the people in the green belt. They're going to tell us that they love us. Go ahead. How awesome is that? How awesome is that? Thank you. We're glad you're here, no matter where you are seated. This is the first of two Good Friday services. We're having another one this evening in the sanctuary at 6:30. Because last year we did it, and we found that it was packed in the morning and packed in the evening, and we want to give people an opportunity to commemorate the death and burial and then anticipating the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So we're glad you came. We're going to have communion in just a little bit. You ever see one of these? Of course you have. And for those who can't see this readily, I'm holding up a crucifix. So I went to church every Sunday growing up, and I saw one of these in the front of the church. Every time I entered the sanctuary, I saw Jesus dying for my sins on the cross. And I remember that had an impact on me. It made me sort of feel guilty all the time. It made me kind of sad and remorseful that he had to go through that. And every week, I was reminded of what he did. It's a good thing, but I think I misunderstood the cross. I think a lot of people misunderstand the cross. I heard about a soldier who was in a war, and he was being shot at, and he jumped into a foxhole, and he started digging with his hands to dig the hole even deeper. And as he was digging, he came across a crucifix inside the dirt of the foxhole that was left by a previous occupant of the foxhole. And he looked at it, and just then two more soldiers jumped into the foxhole to take cover, and along with them, an army chaplain. And when the man who had been there first holding the crucifix saw the army chaplain, he said, "Boy, am I glad to see you. How do you work one of these things?" I think a lot of people don't know how it all works. They don't understand the purpose and the meaning of the cross. Some people look at the cross, and to them, it's just a tragic mistake. It's a travesty of justice. It's a miscarriage of justice. To other people, it's just a symbol. You know, we see crosses all the time. We see them on buildings. People wear crosses as jewelry. People will get crosses tattooed on their bodies. Even around Easter time, you can get chocolate crosses. I mean, how far have we gone away from the meaning of the cross? Do you know, in the early church, nobody would think about wearing a cross because it stood for capital punishment. It'd be like you wearing an electric chair around your neck or a hangman's noose as a piece of jewelry. I suppose if you're in the Adams family, that would be appropriate. But other than that, it wouldn't make sense. To the Jews, the cross was seen as a curse. We even sang that a moment ago from a scripture in Deuteronomy 21, where the Old Testament says, "Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree." Now, you know that the Jews didn't crucify people. They stoned people for capital punishment. It was death by stoning. But if the criminal was really, really bad, sometimes after the criminal died, they would raise him up on a tree, and it would be a deterrent to crime. People would look at that, and they would be warned because of it. But when it came to the Messiah, the Jews never, ever anticipated that the deliverer, the Messiah, the one that they had been looking for, the promised one, would ever suffer, let alone die on a cross. You see, for the Jews, they had a culture of conquest, a conquest culture. They were looking for the Messiah to come and conquer the bad guys, conquer the Romans, set up his kingdom, overthrow the Roman government, and get God's people in charge. That's what they were looking for. They were talking about and wanting and anticipating conquest. Here comes Jesus, not with a conquest culture, but with a cross culture. It's all about the cross. He focused on the cross. In fact, he spoke about the cross as being his glory. And he said, glorify yourself, Father. And he spoke of the cross that he would go to as something that would actually glorify him and glorify the Father. Yes, he will come and conquer. Yes, one day he will overthrow the kingdoms of this world. Yes, one day he and effectively we with him will run things and be in charge. But first, he came in humility. First, he came to make payment for our penalty of sin. You see, when Jesus came, he wanted to instill in his disciples, and they didn't get it, he wanted to instill with them a cross culture. You know, the whole New Testament is a cross culture. It's all about the cross. So many references to the cross, so many benefits of the cross. Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. Galatians 6:14, God forbid that I should boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 6, I was determined to know nothing among you except Christ and him crucified. The cross is mentioned everywhere. We baptize people right here in this pool. In the warmer months, we just had a baptism recently. And what we are symbolizing is death, burial, and resurrection. We put them in the water. We bury them under the water, symbolizing they're dead to the past. And then we bring them out of the water. If they're really bad, we keep them in the water a long time. Make sure all those sins get washed away. But after a minute or two, we bring them up. No, I'm just kidding. We bring them down and we bring them up. But it symbolizes death and burial and resurrection. We take communion because we are showing the Lord's death until he comes. It's all a cross-oriented culture. I don't know if you've been in Sopo recently, Solomon's Porch, right over here, this coffee shop of ours, but we have a logo that makes some people think twice. They look at it and go, what's this about? Because it's a skull. It's a skull, and there's a plant growing through the skull. And we've had so many people come in Sopo and look at that and get disgusted at our logo. And they say, what are you guys doing, celebrating death? And we say, as a matter of fact, we are. That's what Calvary was. We are commemorating the death of Jesus. Do you know, by the way, that Calvary was the place of a skull in the New Testament? Where Jesus died was called Golgotha or Calvary, and it means the Calvarium, the skull. So yes, as a matter of fact, we are celebrating the fact that Jesus became our substitute and died in our place. It's a cross culture. Now, I'm going to read a couple verses out of John chapter 12. John tells the story of Jesus coming to Jerusalem. The second half of his book is all about the final week of Jesus on the earth. And while Jesus comes into Jerusalem, he has just ridden a donkey into Jerusalem. We covered that last Sunday. He then speaks about his death, his impending death. And he says this in verse 27 of John 12. Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I came to this hour. And he continues, Father, glorify your name. And then a voice came from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Now, there's a few things about the cross I want you to make a note of. First of all, the pain of the cross. The pain of the cross. Jesus said, now my soul is troubled. I suppose it was the pain of the cross that is what reminded me every single week when I went into the church what Jesus went through. It looked so painful to be hanging up on that cross and to see blood marks around his brow and around his hands and around his feet. And Jesus alludes to that here. He says, my soul is troubled. The word troubled means shaken, stirred, agitated. I'm emotionally torn up because of this. Now, what was it that caused him to be so troubled? Well, I guess we would obviously think of that physical torture that the cross would bring. It would be horrible, horrific, to have a crown of thorns on one's head, piercing through the scalp, causing immense bloodletting, to have spikes being driven through the wrist bones into the nerves and the searing pain that would cause, to have a whip with pieces of glass and lead embedded in the leather thongs, eating into the flesh of a person's back and being ripped away. All of that was horrific. We can't even imagine. It was the worst possible death in ancient times. And perhaps Jesus is anticipating that. He's thinking of just how bad it's going to be. He knows. He's been living with this his whole life. You know, it's interesting. John talks about the Garden of Gethsemane, but he doesn't go into the detail of the immense physical torture that he went through, even in the Garden of Gethsemane. Luke does. Luke says that Jesus began to sweat like great drops of blood in the Garden of Gethsemane. And though John doesn't go into that kind of detail in the Garden of Gethsemane, he does go into the detail of Jesus' emotional state before the cross. And Jesus just flat out comes out and says, my soul is troubled. My soul is troubled. I think it was more than just anticipating the physical brutality of the cross. Jesus knew that when he was put up on that cross, all of the sins of the world would be effectively dumped upon him. Isn't that what Paul said? God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Isn't that what Paul said to the Galatians? Having redeemed us from the curse of the law, he became a curse himself. Question. Do you know who was supposed to be on that center cross? A guy by the name of Barabbas. Barabbas was a notorious criminal, an insurrectionist. And he sat in jail anticipating, I'm going to die tomorrow along with these other guys. They're going to put me on that center cross because he was the big bad wolf in Jerusalem. Everybody knew it. And can you imagine how shocked he was when somebody came to Barabbas' cell and said, hey, you can go free. What? What do you mean go free? I'm going to die soon. No, no, no. Somebody else in another cell, he's going to die. Here's Barabbas walking around the street, free as a lark. And I don't know what was going through his mind, but I hope this is going through his mind. Whoever that is up on the cross became my substitute. He is literally dying for me. Now, do you know you and I are in a long line of Barabbases? I'm Barabbas. You're Barabbas. Barabbas was the first one Jesus died for, died in his place. But he would die for every single person after Barabbas who would place their faith in him. He became the substitute. And all of that is weighing on Jesus as he says, my soul is troubled. But I think that the real pain that Jesus is experiencing emotionally, more than the physical pain, more even than the sins being dumped upon him, is the effect of having all the world's sin placed upon him, and that is separation from his Father. Because on the cross, he will cry out, my God, why have you forsaken me? You notice he doesn't say that here. He talks to him as Father. He says, Father, glorify your name. But on the cross, he doesn't say Father. On the cross, he is experiencing the separation caused by the sin of the world. And he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? He's experiencing the effect of sin in separating him from his Father. That's the pain of the cross. The second thing to make a note of is the purpose of the cross. Notice what he says. Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I came to this hour. I came to this hour. You see, this was his mission. And effectively, he's saying, Father, I don't turn away from the cross. I'm turning into it. I'm willingly going to the cross because I know it's going to glorify you. Let me just say, that's real courage. Real courage is not being unafraid of danger. Real courage is facing danger, being afraid of it, but doing the right thing anyway. And so he says, what will I say? Father, save me? No, I came for this very reason. This was his life's work. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is called the Lamb who was slain from the foundation of the world. You remember when Jesus was born? And some months later, wise men from the east came and gave him gifts. Do you remember the gifts they gave him? Gold, frankincense, myrrh. Myrrh was an embalming fluid. If I were Mary, I'd be insulted if somebody gave my baby myrrh. Hey, this is for your little baby child. Congratulations. It's embalming fluid. What's all that about? Yes, it had some fragrant qualities to it, but it was used mostly at a time of death. You see, that was predictive of why he had come. He came. He was born. He came into this world that he might die on a cross. So Jesus is speaking about not just the pain of the cross, but the purpose of his life and the purpose of this moment. I have come to this moment. And get this, and I'll be honest, it's a scripture that it's very difficult for me to understand, but it's in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12. It says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. Joy? How could you have any joy facing that kind of a cruel punishment? How could you have any kind of joy knowing that you're going to be separated from your Father with whom you have never experienced separation? Because he looked and saw the effect of what that cross would do, saw all of us gathered here today and places like it around the world, people who love him, people who have been blood bought by him, people who are his sons and daughters by faith in Jesus Christ. He knew that he could save sinners by this act, and that brought him joy. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. A few years ago, many years ago, I was in a movie, and I was asked to play the part of a doctor. It was for the Billy Graham Association, and I played Dr. Bob in this movie. And I asked the producer, I said, why are you calling me? He said, well, at the end of the movie, you know, the doctor is going to have some speaking parts, but at the end of the movie, we want the doctor to stand up in the clinic and give the gospel. I said, well, you can get any actor to do that. I am not an actor. And he says, that's why I'm calling you. We don't want an actor. We actually want somebody who believes this message. I said, okay, I'll do it. I'm your Huckleberry. So when we were on the movie set, we were filming in Puerto Rico. The lead male actor, who was not a believer, he played in Black Hawk Down, and he had lines about the blood of Jesus Christ that he had to say, and it was about, you know, Jesus shedding his blood for sin, etc. And I remember him trying to get these lines out, and he stumbled every time. And finally, in exasperation, he threw his arms up, and he goes, what's the big deal about the blood of Jesus Christ? I mean, can't we just throw this line out? So I saw what was happening, and we had a very lively, interesting discussion. in front of all the actors, and I said, let me tell you something about the blood of Jesus Christ. If there's no shed blood, there's no power. If there's no power, there's no message. If there's no message, there's no hope. If there's no hope, there's no movie. I said, the blood of Jesus Christ is everything. My sins are forgiven because of that. It's a big deal to Christians. So I went on to explain to him, and finally he kind of hung his head and worked his way through the lines. But this, Jesus says, was his purpose. He knew the pain, but he also knew the purpose. And then the final thing is the power of the cross. There are two results. Listen to what it says after this. Therefore, the people who stood by and heard it said that it thundered. This is when God spoke. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus answered and said, this voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples to myself. There's two effects the cross has. First effect is condemnation. Condemnation. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. Do you know that when the world put Jesus up on the cross, it was condemning itself? It was judging itself? It was signing its own death warrant. This is why Paul writes to the Corinthians and he says this, the rulers of this world did not understand. If they did, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. They thought they were getting rid of Jesus. They're judging him. Pilate had Jesus come into his judgment court, and Pilate pronounced judgment on Jesus. He thought he was judging Jesus. Actually, when he said, what shall I do with Jesus who is called the Christ? What he didn't know is whatever he did, he would be judging himself. He would make a judgment, but he will stand face to face with this same man in the future at God's tribunal. So the world was judging itself when they put Jesus on the cross. Also, he says this, now is the judgment of the world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. Effectively, when Jesus died on the cross, he pulled the power, the fangs, out of the mouth of Satan. Satan wanted Jesus dead, not knowing that in getting Jesus crucified, he would be undoing his own domain. The cross was the first casting out of Satan. The second casting out of Satan comes during the Great Tribulation period, when Satan is cast out of heaven. He'll have no access at all to God any longer. Do you know he has access to God right now? He's called the accuser of the brethren. He accuses you before God day and night, the Bible says. But in the tribulation period, Satan will be cast out having no access to God. The third casting out comes at the end of the tribulation period when Satan is placed in chains for 1,000 years so there can be a millennial kingdom. And the fourth casting out is when he is put into the lake of fire forever and ever. Yeah, we should get excited at that. So the power of the cross, first of all, it brings condemnation to the world who wanted to get rid of him and to Satan who tried the same. Second benefit, salvation. It brought salvation. Verse 32, if I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. This he said, John writes, this he said, signifying what death he would die. I got to tell you, this verse, Jesus being lifted up, has been misinterpreted and misunderstood by a lot of people. There are even worship songs that say, let's lift Jesus higher, let's lift him higher, lift him high for the world to see. For Jesus said, if I am lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. He doesn't mean lift him up in the sense of worship and exalting him. when he says, I'll be lifted off the earth, he was talking about being lifted up in shame on a cross. And by that shameful cross, by that willingly giving of his life, he would be able to save people. He would draw all men to himself. Jesus explained that to Nicodemus. He said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So Jesus said, it's the cross that's the center of it all. Many churches these days are trying to remove all mentions of the cross, all mentions of the blood. The church is losing blood because so many pastors are saying, let's not mention death, let's not mention blood, it's gory. People will feel like outsiders. It's not a good thing to think about. Just like I told that guy in the movie, it is absolutely the center of our hope. He died and conquered death by resurrection. You can't have resurrection without death. In dying, he took care of our sin. In rising from the dead, he gave us everlasting life. It's absolutely the center. We can't take the blood away, ever. And this is what draws people to Jesus. It's by his work on the cross that I can have a fresh start. I can have new life. I heard about a man that fell into a pit. And while he was in the pit, he couldn't get out of it. A subjective person came along and said, I feel for you down there in the pit. An objective person came along and said, it's logical that somebody would fall down there. A Christian Science guy came by and said, you only think you're in the pit. A Pharisee said, only bad people fall into a pit. A mathematician calculated how he fell into a pit. A news reporter wanted the exclusive story on the pit. A legalistic Christian said, you deserve your pit. Confucius said, if you would have listened to me, you wouldn't be in that pit. Buddha said, your pit is only a state of mind. A realist said, yep, that's a pit. A scientist calculated the pressure necessary, pounds per square inch, to get him out of the pit. A geologist told him to appreciate the rock strata on the sides of the pit. An evolutionist said, you are a rejected mutant destined to be removed from the evolutionary cycle. In other words, you're going to die in the pit so that you can't produce any pit-falling offspring. The county inspector asked if he had a permit to dig a pit. A self-focused person said, you haven't seen anything till you've seen my pit. A charismatic from the faith movement said, just confess that you're not in the pit. An optimist said, things could be worse. A pessimist said, things will be worse. But then Jesus, seeing the man, took him by the hand and lifted him out of the pit. Everybody has an opinion of why the world is so messed up. Jesus said, for this reason I came. I'm going to glorify the Father. I'm going to die on a cross, that they might have life. Father, thank you for being our substitute, not just for Barabbas, but for Skip and Pete and Sally, Joe, Frank, Jesse, every one of us you substituted for us. We know that was the plan from the beginning. We know that Jesus, although it was painful, there was a certain amount of joy that he had. And so, Father, we are, like has been leveled as an accusation against us, we are celebrating death, the death of Jesus on our behalf, crucified at Skull Hill for us. Lord, I pray if anybody here doesn't know Jesus personally, if this is just sort of a religious thing. Oh, yeah, once a year we do that Good Friday thing and then Easter. But that's all it is. It's just sort of an external ritual, but nothing more. Maybe you're at a place in your life where whatever you've tried hasn't delivered. Listen, you need to get this thing settled once and for all. You need to get this forgiveness of sin thing settled once and for all. You need to get this eternal life thing settled in your life once and for all. And if you have not, up to this point, surrendered your life to Christ, I'm going to invite you to do it right now. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. But if you're willing to say, I want to give Jesus control of my life, I want to surrender my life to him, I want you just to stand to your feet, just for a moment, wherever you are. Just stand up. Stand to your feet. In standing, you're saying, I'm going to stand for Christ from now on. I'm going to make a stand for Jesus Christ personally. God bless you. Just stand to your feet. And while you're standing, say, Lord, I invite you into my life as Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me from my unrighteousness. I believe in Jesus, what he did for me. I turn from my sin. I turn to him as Savior. It's in his name I pray. Amen. We're going to pass the elements of communion out. Once we have them together, then we're going to take them together.
To see lifted out of
Does everybody have the elements? Father, thank you for sending your Son. Thank you for loving the world so much. We think of that verse that everybody knows, for God so loved the world. And thank you, Jesus, for saying yes. For saying, I actually came for this. I came to this hour for this purpose. Father, glorify your name. Thank you for the new life that we have because we believe. Thank you that because we believe, we'll never see eternal death. We'll live forever. Father, we pray especially right now for those that we know and love who are sick, who are infirmed, who are unable to be here. Encourage them, give them hope. Some of them are facing a very difficult road ahead. We pray that you give them strength. Thank you that the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses a man, a woman from all sin. So we take this, Lord, as a testament, a testimony of our faith in the finished work of Jesus. We can't add to it. We are, in effect, celebrating, commemorating his death. By his death, we have life. Amen. Let's take together.
Church, we'll stand back to our feet as we continue in worship. We're going to sing this song of celebration. Maybe you prayed that prayer the first time and you're looking to have your relationship with the Lord rattled, shaken up. Maybe you've let some purpose die down and it needs some shaking up. We're going to celebrate today.
Yeah, man.
Celebrate on Easter Sunday that our God didn't stay dead, but he is alive right now. He rose from the grave to conquer sin and death. Again, 7:30 a.m. Lobo Stadium. We're looking forward to joining you there, 9 and 11, back at our Osuna campus. It's going to be a party. There is nothing like a resurrection party, so we look forward to joining you there. Reminder that we have Vitalant blood services here till 3 p.m. Blood saves lives is what we just celebrated. So if you want to give blood to save people's physical lives, we encourage and invite you to do that. And then finally, I have in my hand a little square card, and we're going to have a table up here right after the service. If you didn't get one of these, this isn't any kind of paper. This is seed paper. In this paper are a bunch of little wildflower seeds. When this paper is planted in the ground, give it a couple months and wildflowers will come out of it. This whole theme, into the ground, from the ground. A seed has to die for beautiful things to come from it. Jesus died so that beautiful things could come from his resurrection. So maybe you have something in your life that you need to put to death this weekend, and you need to watch God bring something new from it. So take one of these home, write down what it is in your life that you need to die in order for new things to come from it, then plant it in the ground and watch beauty come from ashes. God bless you, church. We love you. We'll see you on Sunday. Once again, happy Good Friday.